I've been talking to Senator Tom Cotton, the Republican senator for Arkansas, who wrote a letter signed by 44 other senators pledging support for Boris Johnson in the event that we leave the EU without a deal.
Well, I respect Larry Summers' views, but on this one, I would have to disagree. I think the European Union needs to strike a bargain as well. I would commend Prime Minister Johnson for recognizing what I think is probably one of the fatal flaws of Theresa May's approach to this, is not being prepared for a no-deal Brexit. Obviously, that gives away whatever leverage Great Britain had with the European Union. I know that's not the preferred approach of the Prime Minister or probably a majority of the Parliament at this point, but one always must prepare for these contingencies, especially in these kinds of negotiations. I express no particular opinion on the kind of agreement that the UK and the EU might pursue. I and all of my colleagues simply want the British people to know that we will stand with them both before and after the Brexit.
On the question of a trade deal between the United States and the United Kingdom, isn't Britain in a weaker position? That's certainly Larry Summers' view.
Well, in that regard, I would say that Great Britain is in a pretty strong position. Again, we have highly complementary economies. This is not the kind of trade deal, have very mismatched economies. We're going to have large flows of, say, manufacturing jobs one way and high tech or advanced economic jobs the other way. So I'm pretty optimistic about getting a good deal that benefits both of our nations.
Well, of course, we've all heard President Trump's slogan, America First. And isn't that the approach that he's likely to take to these negotiations?
He does like to say America first, as any nation's leader does. He puts our nation's interests first. But he's also said on many occasions, going back to the immediate aftermath of the 2016 Brexit vote, that he would like to see a free trade agreement with Great Britain. And he sees it being a pretty sweeping free trade agreement as well, in no small part because our economies are so complementary.
But interesting that you acknowledge that it could take some time. And some estimates have been, well, Barack Obama said that such a trade deal could take 10 years to negotiate.
Well, he said that in the context of the fear-mongering campaign during the Brexit vote when he traveled to the country and said that Great Britain would have to get in the back of the queue. I and many of my colleagues in the Congress would say that Great Britain should be in the front of the queue, given everything our nations have gone through together and given the benefits we can both reap from a free trade agreement between our two nations. Obviously, it wouldn't be a matter of days or weeks for such negotiations. It might be months, but I would suspect it would be months, not years.
Months, not years, but even given the difficulties that you would acknowledge coming as you do from an agricultural estate, the kind of issues around, we've talked about subsidies, but also about standards. I mean, presumably your farmers would want British farmers to comply to US standards.
Well, again, those can be negotiated. I mean, in some matters, Great Britain has different standards than the United States when it comes to, say, the use of GMOs in crop production. Those are details to be negotiated. But the fundamental point is the United States Congress stands ready to support the British people in a post-Brexit environment, however they choose to leave the European Union.
How strongly would you push the idea of genetically modified crops?
I think the evidence shows that they're safe, that they can increase yields, which ultimately leads to lower prices for all consumers and less food shortages around the world. I understand that Europeans, to include the British, have different views, but again, that's a detail to be negotiated between our two governments.
A very big part of the negotiations between the UK and Europe is about the Good Friday Agreement, and that's something that's been taken up by some American politicians, in particular Nancy Pelosi, the Democratic Speaker of the House of Representatives. And she's been saying if there were to be any weakening of the Good Friday Accords, then there'd be no chance whatsoever, a non-starter for a US-UK trade agreement.
Yes, I know that Speaker Pelosi has said that. It may not surprise your listeners to know that I would disagree with Speaker Pelosi. That is a matter for the United Kingdom and Ireland and for the European Union, and that American politicians ought not be weighing in with threats trying to impose their view of what the United Kingdom's relationship should be to Ireland in particular, or the European Union.
But American involvement was very important in the peace process, which led to the Good Friday Agreement. And there is strong feelings in Congress about the prospect of a hard border returning. And wouldn't that mean that the idea of ratifying any trade deal could be held up because of those concerns?
Well, to be fair to the UK and Ireland, they reached the agreement. It wasn't Americans. I mean, Americans helped facilitate it in the ways we have in other areas around the world. But ultimately, it was the decision of the governments of the UK and Ireland to reach the Good Friday Accords. And we should not use our trade policy to try to influence the way the United Kingdom makes decisions about its own sovereign prerogatives. I understand the backstop is one of the most controversial parts of Ireland, and you've got different cross-cutting pressures. Those are thorny, complicated questions, to be sure. I'm confident that your government can work those out without the, you know, unsolicited advice of politicians in our government.
But given those strong feelings in Congress and the difficulties which you would acknowledge in terms of the negotiations, doesn't that make your estimate of months rather than years for a trade agreement quite optimistic?
No, I don't think it does. It's one thing for politicians to talk about what they will and won't do in the abstract years in advance. But it's another thing whenever you have a good agreement put in front of you that is going to advance the interests of our citizens and increase our shared prosperity to vote against it.